All right. Welcome, everyone. Feels like we've aged a lot, considering what's been happening since the last time we had a show. A lot of exciting stuff, right? I think it's quite obvious that there's a lot of new excitement about IOTA and what we've been building. What I'm really most excited about is that all of those people that have started reaching out to me again, right? OGs, big whales, and investors that really show a profound excitement about IOTA, right? And it was a very crucial decision that we have kickstarted with IOTA Rebased. Obviously, right now the voting is going on and it looks pretty phenomenal. I think it's like 98 or 95% in favor of it. And we should be reaching the threshold, 5% threshold, very soon. And so I think the community is very excited about IOTA Rebased. The market is very excited about IOTA Rebased. And so I think we have a perfect combination here. Now, obviously, the most important part is that we keep the momentum going, right? Because we are here to play the big league and we're here to deliver big things. And IOTA Rebased for us was always just the start, right? And with IOTA Rebased, we finally have the right technology. We have the right momentum right now to really capitalize on some bigger things, partnerships, adoption cases that we bring to IOTA mainnet, and real differentiation of IOTA as one of the leaders in this market. And I think that's what we are really here for, to see IOTA win and be at the top again. And I think that's really exciting, and what we can do this year and what we can do next year and for the years to come. What we're going to do today is sort of AMA. All of you have been sending us your questions on Discord. If you're not on the Discord yet, obviously make sure to join it. We love our community and we really want to see it grow. And so what I'll do today together with Luca is obviously go through these questions, answer them, and give you our perspective. I think just to set expectations straight, this is not a show for us to pre-announce things. This is not a show for us to unnecessarily hype things up. But you should see this as more of us speaking together with all of you, right? Talking about IOTA, talking about what excites us, answering the questions that you may have, and then with that, moving forward. So don't expect any pre-announcements, but expect a lot of our opinions and why we are excited about what's happening. So you better understand the strategy and the direction that we're taking with IOTA. With that said, let me get Luca on stage. Hello, Luca.
Hey everyone, how are you doing? How are you doing?
Very good, very good. It's a lot of exciting stuff. You know, like I can wear a hat finally because I'm too lazy to do my hair.
looks good.
so it's a good hairstyle. Let me get questions on here. Mm-hmm. Once I can share the screen. All right, let me zoom in so it's more visible. So just so y'all know, the way that we've done it this time is we went through all the questions on Discord, and the ones with the most emojis, whether good, whether bad, or positive or negative questions, we have selected here, right? So these are really the questions selected from Discord channel, right? From the Discord channel. Let me go through this. Can you explain how Realize brings value to the IOTA ecosystem beyond TVL? Is the ecosystem benefiting proportionally to founders of new ventures? I think how does Realize benefit IOTA is you should think about it similarly to Twin, right? Where Twin is there to build up this entire trade and logistics ecosystem on IOTA and has been doing that since 2018. Realize is doing the same for tokenization, right? And one thing that we've realized is that, no pun intended, is that we need to have flagship projects in each domain. It doesn't make sense for IOTA to have dApps in our ecosystem that are present on 10 other chains, right? Because then we're not a very unique ecosystem because we just have the same as everybody else. And for us to win in this market, we really need to differentiate IOTA. And we really make sure that IOTA is at the top in terms of utility for the token, in terms of adoption cases, and in terms of new things that you can invest into. So this is why Realize is sort of like a strategic partner in the ecosystem to build up this tokenization ecosystem. Starting out with the first tokenized a treasury bill fund that was set up in ADGM, and now bringing actually more yield-bearing assets on-chain on the IOTA. So I think in that regard, it really helps to position IOTA very uniquely in the RWA sector, because Realize is really focused on IOTA. It also tokenizes it assets on other networks, but the core of the business is being built on IOTA, right? Where the assets are being tokenized and where they're actually being provided new utility, right? Stablecoins, new yield farms, and also trading. So that's how it benefits the ecosystem. If the ecosystem benefits founders proportionally, I would say the main thing is it benefits those that come in early, right? There's no unfair treatment being done by projects. And I think we've done a really exceptional job with our grant program and our liquidity provision, that all those projects that have joined the ecosystem have received equal support, right? With the liquidity provision and also in terms of the grants. And so I think it is a level playing field. But what we definitely encourage builders to do is to get in early, right? Because that's where most of the opportunities in the ecosystem are. And so we, as the foundation, we don't try to judge, but we really try to make a strategic decision on what to support and what not to support, right? And so I think in that regard, it is a level playing field. Is IoT machine economy still a core focus? Which products or companies are currently being targeted? Maybe I should answer this one, right? Like, the whole machine economy vision behind IOTA over the years has fundamentally evolved, right? The IOTA of 2024 is no longer just focused on one segment, one industry, right? Because IOTA in 2017, we were really the IoT chain, right? Focus on the machine economy use cases, working on with big companies on those IoT-related use cases and positioning ourselves through that. In 2024, IOTA is so much more than just machine economy, right? Like, we're working on tokenization, we're doing trade finance. We have a whole range of financial applications, digital identity for humans, for machines, but also for organizations, and digital product passports, right? So I would say, and obviously everything that we're doing in Web3 and DeFi, right? So it is that IOTA is no longer just having one industry, so to say, but we have many different industries and many different use cases that we're working on. So I would say that machine economy is no longer a core focus, but it's just one of the areas that are being built by builders in our ecosystem. I don't know if you want to say anything, Luca, or that's fine.
No, I think you summarized it very well.
Okay. Is IOTA working with the World Economic Forum to accelerate IoT adoption? We're working with the World Economic Forum to accelerate trade finance and trade logistics adoption, right? Specifically, we're working with them on TWIN, right? The Trade Worldwide Information Network. So it's called the TWIN.org. So if you guys go to TWIN.org, which, by the way, is an awesome domain. Very, very proud that we got that one. And TWIN is basically, I would say, a foundation that is now focused on building up this trade and logistics infrastructure to digitize trade, right? And it's built on IOTA, and it's there to help digitize trade documents and also trade processes, and then also help them to tokenize those assets. And we're working together with the World Economic Forum, Tony Blair Institute, Trademark Africa, Global Alliance for Trade Facilitation, and the Institute of Export in the UK, to build out this consortium and to build out the TWIN infrastructure. So I would say WEF is an amazing partner of ours in advancing the adoption of TWIN. And the TWIN Foundation is being set up in Geneva, and it's going to be hosted by the World Economic Forum. And so we're very proud to be working with them, because they're obviously one of the biggest and most reputable organizations when it comes to government relations and government adoption. And so I think it's very exciting to be working with them. So if you haven't checked out TWIN yet, make sure to go to twin.org. For those who are confused about TLIP versus twin.org, so TLIP was started in Kenya. So TLIP is the infrastructure in Kenya, and TWIN is sort of like the global infrastructure, but both of them are connected with each other. And TLIP is sort of like the predecessor of TWIN. And TWIN is now the big organization, the umbrella name for the infrastructure. And TLIP is the infrastructure that is running right now in Kenya to digitize trade, right, for traders. Would providing project outlines and roadmaps on that roadmap improve transparency for investors? I'll give this one to you,
Luca. Oh, that's a good question. I mean, obviously, we want to start having roadmaps again, so people know more or less, you know, what our engineering roadmap is and what we try to push. I believe not so much for investors. Those are more meant for developers and builders who actually understand and, you know, want to know what upcoming features are coming. But yeah, of course, like providing roadmaps also gives investors, I guess, some more information that they can use to think about why they're investing into our project or not.
I think it's important to mention that we don't want to give like a roadmap in terms of a timeline, because I think timelines in crypto are just really horrible, but really more of a trajectory of where we want to go, right? More of the big initiatives that we want to get off the ground, right?
That's true. Like if we ever, like, we're going to have roadmaps again, but they will be more structured in the way of saying, this is phase one, this is phase two, and, you know, like basically the chronological order of how things are supposed to happen, but not when, because it's incredibly difficult to have an estimate on those type of things, and then usually in practice they are overshot or delayed by a wide margin. So it's better to just give, you know, the idea to the people who look at the roadmap. These are the steps that we are taking, and then you can, you know, yourself kind of anticipate what the progress on those is if you are more sophisticated and can look at the code, etc.
Yeah. Next question, are there plans for tokenization initiatives in Singapore? Absolutely, right? Like, Singapore is a very important market for us, and we have some amazing partners there, like John from Signum Capital and the whole team there. And we also have some discussions with some banks and financial institutions there. And I think Singapore is obviously a very regulated market, which is obviously positive in that regard. I think what we're looking for there right now is really some partners to work with. So potentially some tokenization platforms out of Singapore will be getting a grant so that we will support them to tokenize on IOTA as well. And then we're moving forward with that. But I think Singapore is a very important market that we want to do more. And not just do stuff in Abu Dhabi, but also in Singapore, right? So I think there are definitely plans and already concrete discussions to bring some tokenization platforms to IOTA to tokenize on there. But nothing is finalized yet. So I think once it's finalized, we'll obviously share these things. Is IF preparing for a new bull run, and what strategies are in place for this phase? I would say we are always preparing for what's next. And that obviously shows with Rebased, which was started, I don't know, like 8 to 10 months ago or so, right? And now it was released in the market. Was very well received. And what we focus on at the moment is to make sure that Rebased launches on the IOTA mainnet as quickly as possible, right? Like sometime early 2025, based on the results of the testnet. Also obviously making sure that the most important partners in this regard, or stakeholders, which are the exchanges, have completed their integrations. And then we're ready to ship it on mainnet and move that forward. And so our focus then is really on sort of like growth initiatives and campaigns to drive on-chain volume and on-chain activities. Just today, I think we reached like 90 million in TVL on the EVM. So I think that's a huge, huge milestone that we've achieved. Honestly, when I gave the comment of 100 million TVL by the end of the year, there's always like a little bit of uncertainty if we're going to be right or not. That's the nature of predictions. But I think we're going to hit that and go well beyond that. And so our focus will really be on how we can attract more on-chain activity and liquidity, right? Because we need to get from 100 million to a billion in TVL, right? We need to really be much more ambitious with our targets now and what we're going to achieve, right? And so obviously everything that we're doing constantly is to make IOTA better, right? So whether it's a bull market, whether it's a bear market, we're constantly building, right? And we've been doing that since 2015. Think about that. It's close to a decade soon. That we've been operating in this market. And so now, obviously, there's a lot of excitement in the market, and we obviously have a lot of initiatives that we're doing publicly, but also behind closed doors to make sure that we're capitalizing on that. And I think what's been happening in the market speaks for itself. speaks for itself, right? And so otherwise, we obviously focus on delivering stuff and not just doing things based on price, right? Is IOTA still following the trillions are nothing narrative? I would just clarify, it's not IOTA, but this was a statement that I made. And I 100% stand behind this, right? Because if we achieve what we want to achieve with IOTA, it is going to host trillions of dollars worth of assets on chain, right? This is what we're all here for. We're here to really bring the real world on chain. And there's no compromise on either we achieve this in a big way or it's going to zero, right? And these technologies, including IOTA, didn't fulfill their purpose, didn't fulfill their vision, right? Obviously, I believe they were much closer to trillions than to nothing, especially with Rebased and everything that we're doing right now. And so what we at the foundation and in the whole ecosystem are focused on is really partnering with enterprises, partnering with governments, and obviously empowering builders around the world to build new applications to bring this activity on chain, right? Whether it's tokenization of assets, whether it's trading of those tokenized assets, whether it's about giving people and companies digital identities so they can identify themselves, all of that is contributing towards that vision of building this on-chain economy, right? And so I firmly believe that this is an all or nothing situation, right? Either these protocols, including IOTA, will be worth trillions and are bringing these assets on chain, or they will be worth nothing, right? And so this is really the whole premise and the whole promise behind these technologies. And obviously, that's why there's all this hype and excitement around the cryptocurrencies and around blockchains. Yeah. What will IOTA bring to the DLT field that others haven't? Luca, do you want to take it?
Yeah, sure. I think here I just want to emphasize that, you know, IOTA, I think compared to other DLTs, has a very strong focus with, you know, actually onboarding real world applications and having the right relationships with the, you know, specific partners and governments. So that's like, you know, from a non-technological side. And from a technological one, I would say that, of course, we have, you know, a very good community. We have very nice developer experience. If you compare it to other chains, people oftentimes tell us that we, you know, communicate with them, like with builder teams. We are much better in communicating with them and helping them out if they compare us to other DLTs. And I guess, you know, with the progress that we will make on IOTA Rebased over time, we might get faster or cheaper or more distributed or more decentralized. That's pretty much a current state, I would say.
Yeah, I would just also highlight, right? Like IOTA isn't just another DeFi chain, right? Because the way that this market works is usually everybody follows a similar playbook, right? And tries to maximize that playbook as much as possible so they can profit a specific cycle. Right. And IOTA for almost 10 years right now has been pursuing a very consistent strategy. Right. And that was to get on-chain activity through real world adoption. Right. And that's where we've built up some really amazing projects like Twin that I've mentioned, like Realize, like digital product passports, like digital identity. All of those use cases we're now bringing on-chain to IOTA with Rebased. Right? And so I would say that one of the key differentiators that we have is in our adoption strategy, right? And working with regulators, working with governments, and we have built up that trust and that reputation in the market over the last 9 years. Right? And that's something that nobody else has. So I think that is definitely one of the key benefits. The other one is that we have a really amazing team, right? And we have a lot of experience from building in the market, from doing research on the core protocol consensus algorithms, right? And everything that makes up a very well-functioning DLT. And so now I think we're also in a very good position to optimize and improve upon Rebased. And I think that's really exciting, right? Because we have one of the most exciting technology stacks now with Rebased. We have the MoveVM, we also have the EVM. And now our team is really able to take what is there and take it to the next level. And I think we're in a really, really strong position to make sure that IOTA is unique from an adoption standpoint, right? Where you can do things on IOTA that you cannot do on any other network, where we are going to see governments being connected to IOTA, building on IOTA, publishing transactions, right, daily, consuming IOTA tokens as well. And also where all of you will be empowered to actually participate in this ecosystem, invest into tokenized assets, trade them, and so on, but where we're also going to differentiate technologically, right, and set us apart from the rest. So I think that combination is really exciting. Why haven't Arab investors shown more interest in IOTA? I don't know how you say that they haven't, right? Like maybe there hasn't been like a lot of interest publicly, but a lot of the discussions that I've been having was definitely also with family offices and investors out of the whole MENA region, right? And so I think we as IOTA, we haven't done a lot of effort in promoting ourselves there, because I think we've also been holding a little bit back, waiting on Rebased. But I can definitely say that there's been a lot of interest from the region, and that we'll continue to do that, right? Like next week, I'm speaking at Abu Dhabi Finance Week, where I will present sort of our vision for tokenization with Realize and with IOTA, and where we are also going to meet with a lot of institutional investors, especially also from the region, right? So Abu Dhabi is one of our homes for IOTA, and we definitely want to be positioned very strategically there, right? Because it is a very exciting market from a regulatory standpoint, but also from an adoption standpoint. And so I think a lot of more work can be done there. And maybe together with some exchanges and some partners, we can then actually do some promotion there, right? Because without exchanges, you can't buy IOTA, right? And so I think this is really something that we'll work on promoting. What is the current state of Cordiside? What are the challenges? What does the rollout plan look like?
Yeah, there's a bunch of questions targeting IOTA 2.0 for whatever reason. I mean, maybe you missed this. On Dariel, 2 weeks ago, we released the IOTA Rebased announcement. So we aren't working on Cordiside anymore, or you can say that with IOTA Rebased, we execute Cordiside. But maybe I just say, like, for IOTA Rebased, at least right now, right, we are auditing the code, we are testing the code, we are onboarding validators, getting to know that process, how that works. And then somewhere in early 2025, if the vote passes, we're going to release IOTA Rebased. But Cordiside, or what has been known as IOTA 2.0, is not something that we're working on, because that is getting replaced by IOTA Rebased.
Yeah, exactly. I mean, Cordiside is pretty much done then, right? Like you can really say that it's mission accomplished, because effectively what we're going to have is a network with 150 validators, right, fully decentralized, and with staking, right? So all of that is live. So make sure to read the announcement post from today, where you can then find out about some of the new institutional grade validators that are going to join the IOTA Rebase network as well. Why focus on anything other than Cordiside at this point? Honestly, like I think some people might not have read the
no, I don't think so.
The blog post or don't know about Rebase yet. I don't know.
Yeah, again, right. We are doing IOTA Rebased because we did not want, like, if we could have done IOTA 2.0 Cordiside and then, you know, brought layer one smart contracts onto it, but that would have just taken too much time and broken the protocol twice for anybody integrating or building on top of IOTA. That's why we are doing IOTA Rebased. So we're not working on IOTA 2.0 or on Cordiside. We are working currently on IOTA Rebased, and that's the thing that gets shipped in early 25 if the current vote passes.
Will IOTA 2.0 ever be true, fully feeless and free of the coordinator?
Again, I think it goes into the same direction. IOTA Rebased, I will just substitute IOTA 2.0 with IOTA Rebased here, I guess. It's not going to be fully feeless, because we also think that exposing fees to user and developers is actually the easiest way for them to understand, you know, that having a decentralized system where there are actors which are putting up services or which are running the network, in some way need to be compensated for, respectively. There needs to also be a way in which you can, you know, kind of prioritize transactions, which usually is done via fees. And again, IOTA Rebased is going to be free of the coordinator, because it's going to be a decentralized network consisting currently in the current protocol version with up to 150 validators, right? And those validators are partaking in a proof of stake system. So it's a decentralized network. Everybody can try to become a validator if they get enough stake or enough, delegated stake to them.
Yeah. And maybe just to mention about the feeless nature, right? Like, we are also working on sponsored transactions. So there's also a way actually for application developers to effectively pay the fees for the users, so that the users will at the end of the day have feeless transactions. But and somebody obviously has to pay the fees. And in this regard, in this case, it would be the application builder, or it could also be validators or others who are sponsoring the fees. And with that, you can really also still do feeless transactions. Well, so it's not fully removed from the protocol, but it's actually being achieved through different means right now. And it doesn't make sense to do it for the entire network anymore, but really do it for specific use cases.
And actually, this is much more elegant, right, than what we would have had with IOTA 2.0 with the mana system, because you get, like with IOTA Rebased, you gain the advantage of a system which you understand, like it's very easy to understand, but additionally, you can create services and applications where essentially your users might not even need the token to interact with the application that you've built on the the chain. Yeah,
and that's super exciting, right? Because then you can really unlock so many new UX flaws, because I think all of us have experienced the pain of having tokens in a network where you don't hold the native gas token. Is one of the most terrible user experiences ever in crypto. I think the only thing I can compare it to is when you buy a movie and it's only available in German, but you want it in English on Amazon Prime or an Apple TV, and it's just so fucking frustrating, because it's like, why don't you have it available in the original language? It's always like such a painful process. But I think with this, I think one of the key things that we can really innovate on is removing this friction for end users to engage with the network and engage with applications. Because at the end of the day, it should be very seamless for you to use the IOTA network, and very seamless to use the applications being built on top of the IOTA network, because that's how we succeed, right? And so sponsored transactions is really one of the ways in which we'll achieve that. Why was IOTA 2.0 deprioritized in favor of the secret project? I mean, there was like a whole blog post on this, right? I really encourage you to read the IOTA Rebased blog post. It's like 10 pages, but it's very nicely done. The main summary is all about time to market, right? How do we make sure that IOTA is competitive now instead of having to wait for another 2 years to integrate the MoveVM into IOTA 2.0, right? So effectively, it was about being pragmatic. It was about rebasing the ledger and our technology so that we can then move forward much faster. And that's really the main gist of it. So I encourage you to read the blog post. I think this next question is also like, doesn't really make much sense, to be honest. So let's move forward to the next questions. Will realized T-bills yield be accessible through IOTA tokens, and how would that work for non-crypto users? It will be possible to invest into the fund through IOTA tokens. So there will be a broker effectively that will accept IOTA tokens and then exchange the IOTA tokens into the T-bill, R-bill token, right? Which is the fund unit in the realized T-bill fund. The yield itself, and it also goes the other way, right? Like when you sell the T-bills, you can then also exchange the T-bill into IOTA tokens and get the IOTA tokens back. So at the end of the day, yes, it's possible. And the way that it will be achieved is through a broker that is being onboarded by the Realize platform right now. Is the ST Micro partnership still active, and is IOTA used in their microchips? Do you know that?
I do not.
I think the last time we were in contact with them was a couple of months ago, and we also updated them on Rebased. And they have been building, and they were a strong builder back in the day. I don't think that they are right now working on Rebased, but this is definitely something that we should check up with them. So I would say at the end of the day, it's probably not active anymore, because we also don't really do IoT use cases anymore. And so I don't think it really made that much sense. Is IOTA still involved with ADAX CityBot or Campus Free City in Frankfurt? We're still involved with ADAC, but I don't know about the CityBot, because I think it was more of an innovation showcase. And so we're not really part of that anymore. Is Project Avarium still ongoing? It's being built by Matthew, right, who left the foundation to build it. And he's still moving forward with the project and recently actually won an award on that. So congrats to him. So yes, the project is still ongoing. Are Zebra scanners or related logistics projects still incorporating IOTA? Yes. So we're still in close contact with Zebra. We're actually thinking about working on a traceability pilot together with them. And so those projects are still moving forward. And it was more that we had other priorities than focus on traceability, because we obviously first focused on the ports and the governments before expanding the use cases. But now we are starting to work on traceability for logistics as well. What projects do you think should be built on IOTA that aren't being worked on yet? Do you want to take it first?
Oof, yeah, that's a really tough question, I think. I mean, now with IOTA Rebased, right? We finally get to get all the actual usual applications that you would find, you know, on other chains on the layer one. So I would expect people to really, you know, build their standard DeFi applications, and perhaps even in a more performant way and more approachable way, given that, as far as I see, it should be easier to really do them with the Move programming language. So yeah, I'm just very excited to see like what kind of DeFi applications or what kind of new flavors of DeFi applications would be built. But yeah, of course, we are also, you know, from the foundation perspective, building up identity libraries and trust chain libraries, etc. So I would love to see applications which leverage those Move packages and also, well, whatever TypeScript libraries to build another, you know, dApp on top of it, basically. So really, you know, us, right, we provide those libraries and people then using them to create more sophisticated services and identity use cases. So I would really love to see actual sophisticated identity use cases, because I think if you look at different DLTs or chains, whatever, you don't really see them flourishing that much. And I think oftentimes it has a lot to do because it's not really getting pushed by the specific foundation or company which, you know, develops a chain. But because at IOTA we have, you know, we really want to push this, I think there's a lot of potential for people to build applications in that direction.
Yeah, exactly. What I'm really excited about is everything related to mobile, right? Like, I really want to finally use IOTA every day on my phone, right? Whether it's a wallet, whether it's some kind of exchange, whether it's some way launchpad or other things like an identity wallet, like you said, right? I think it would be really amazing to finally see mobile applications popping up. And so really increase the utility of IOTA in the real world, right? And so I think that would be really exciting. I'm also really excited to see stablecoins minting on IOTA natively, so that you can actually use IOTA as the infrastructure to transfer these stablecoins, right? Pay for things online, pay for things in real life, using IOTA as the infrastructure to do that. So yeah, I think ultimately what we are focused on right now is to empower the builders, right, the community, to build whatever they envision on IOTA, and then get to market with it. And so I think we really have the right tech and the right infrastructure for people to do that. Any updates on the cost optimization research paper for IOTA in IoT? I don't know which paper that is. Most likely somebody external, like somebody in the ecosystem that has written such a paper. I think it's best suited to probably answer that person. Beyond T-bills, are there plans to tokenize stocks, ETFs, or commodities? What's IOTA's competitive edge in the RWA sector? The answer is yes, right? So there's a lot more assets that we want to bring on-chain. And there's also a lot more partners beyond Realize that we're working on to bring RWAs on IOTA. Tokenized stocks is actually something that we'll share something very soon, because the team has been getting some exciting project on board there, so that you all get access to tokenized stocks. ETFs and commodities, money market funds, right, whatever, private equity funds. We want to have it all on the network because ultimately investors should have a range of different asset classes to choose from and then invest and manage all of their assets on chain. My personal objective is really to make it possible to do wealth management fully on chain, right? So you don't need to go to a Swiss private bank anymore, but you can actually have AI and have also fully managed vaults on chain that will help you to allocate your money, right? And in order to realize that vision, we need to have these tokenized assets on chain. We need to make them composable so that they can then be put into smart contracts and vault systems so that all of you can do wealth management in a fully non-custodial manner, right? And so I think that's really where we want to take this. Our competitive edge in all of this is our regulatory approach and our connections, right? So as we've seen in ADGM, where we've helped to set up the first tokenized fund focused on T-bills, and now bringing more tokenized funds there that are then obviously tokenizing on IOTA. And then other than that, it's identity, right? We have core focus on identity, integrating that deeply into the protocol as well. And then ultimately, it's about our connections and our network, right? Like we have a foundation that has been operating for the last 9 years in the market, or actually like 7 years because it was founded in 2017. And we also have a proven track record working with governments, working with enterprises. And right now we're really working on sort of like this institutional adoption for IOTA. So all of that is happening. And I think we have a very competitive advantage over other protocols that are just trying to get into this sector. So obviously we want to leverage that a lot more. Another thing that I'm really excited about working on, by the way, is to really work on the institutional adoption for the IOTA token itself, right? Like whether it's ETPs, exchange traded products in Europe, or whether it's actual ETFs in the US. Now that we have staking for IOTA and the IOTA token itself is a yield bearing asset, that proposal and that proposition of setting up these funds specifically for IOTA is much easier to sell, right? And so this is something that we are where we're having a lot of conversations right now to move that forward to make it easier and make it more accessible for people, investors, in the institutional investors to invest into IOTA. Will Realize operate solely on layer two, or is layer one also involved? Right now, obviously, everything happens on the layer two EVM, but our focus with the move VM is that we also bring these tokenized assets on the layer one, and then they can also be bridged to the EVM. What are your expectations for TVL generated by Realize on IOTA EVM? I think the goal is that the fund itself raises between 50 to 100 million over the next 12 months, right? For the T-bill fund, but also for the other funds that are being set up, and that those tokenized assets will then hopefully also be deployed in sort of DeFi yield generating strategies on IOTA, right? So we are quite hopeful that with that, we can really bring, have sort of like an institutional on-ramp. But it's not just Realize that it's doing this, right? We also have other projects, other RWAs, right? There's one focused on tokenized invoices, right? Tokenized stocks is coming very soon. And there's also other RWAs, right? And funds that are being tokenized by other entities. So I do think that over the next 12 months, we can build up a very sizable RWA ecosystem on IOTA. Are there plans to improve the developer tooling and libraries for easier onboarding?
So I take this. Yeah, of course. So I mean, for the foundation, it's always a goal to make the development on our chain as easy as possible. So we have an internal developer experience team whose job is to, you know, solely tackle this issue on providing better documentation and libraries, etc. So, I mean, obviously, right, we had to learn IOTA Rebased, the new code base, and assimilate ourselves with it. But yeah, over the next couple of months and then 25 especially, you know, we are making a huge push in trying to make everything easier for developers. And I think there's a lot of areas where we can do improvements on the current tooling side of things for IOTA Rebased. And yeah, we are also looking forward and basically, you know, getting feedback from builders and understanding what kind of issues they are facing, and, you know, then assess, okay, what can we do to help them basically achieve their goals in an easier way. And you know, obviously, libraries, we always try to make them easier at maybe higher level of abstractions. But yeah, it's definitely something that we effectively push from our side.
I think one thing that I also want to encourage everybody is like, we're setting up a builder Discord, right? I think it will be announced very soon and shared with all of you. And it will be really amazing to get a lot of feedback, right? Because our team will be there, and it would be really good to understand whether some of the documentation, whether some of the examples are not clear enough or are not working. So please give us as much feedback as possible, right? So that we can really improve this, because we have a dedicated team really just focused on developer experience, right? And it's really, really critical that all of you who have a bad, especially if you have a bad experience, right, that you give us that information so that we can then make sure that it's really the best and that it can be, because developers is really our main target audience for IOTA. Is funding available for developers building on IOTA?
Yes, of course, right? We have the grant program. So if you go to iotadlt.foundation, there's a website where you can sign up or submit your grant application. And yeah, we then basically have a committee internally which, you know, looks at those applications and assesses whether we want to fund a certain grant. And I think that's the main way on how you can get funding for your project.
I think right now we've just put a hold on the grants program temporarily because we were like waiting for Rebased to be out as well, right? And so I think now that it's out and the developers have some more time to think about it, we'll relaunch it very soon, right? So that all of you can apply to get funding again and get support through the grants program. Next question: when will the new Layer 1 for IOTA be available? How can developers plan for it?
Yeah, I think so if you're a developer right now and you want to be ready for when, you know, IOTA Rebased hits mainnet, just start looking at the documentation right now, get yourself familiar with the Move programming language, you know, do some toy examples, do some tutorials, and basically, you know, install all the tooling, the CLI tooling, already get to know it, because, you know, the sooner you start, the better it's going to be. So IOTA Rebased, again, will be available once we have done all the audits, once we feel that, you know, we are confident that what we have done, especially, you know, our tokenomics changes, etc., are all stable and work. And then, of course, you know, it's also... It depends on integrations, which we have with third parties, right? So, for example, with exchanges, we want to launch IOTA Rebased on mainnet, of course, when exchange integration is also there. It's basically, right, we are in a testing phase right now. We are also familiarizing ourselves with the process of, you know, onboarding and having actual, you know, a decentralized pool of validators. And there's still some lessons to learn in there, but yeah, again, right, early 2025 is what we are planning with.
Yeah, very nice. Why does the IF sometimes vote in governance and sometimes not? Shouldn't there be clear rules? I want to mention one thing here, right, or 2 points. All right, first of all, the IF does not hold majority of the tokens, right? We're not the VC coin. We do not own majority of the tokens. The 90-95% of all IOTA tokens today are out there fully distributed, right, and in the hands of the community. And so IOTA had one of the largest or most diverse token distributions out of any other project, right? Because we have been trading on the market for I think like 7 or 8 years now. Right, so there was an effective token distribution for 8 years happening in the market. So there's not the large concentration in the hands of a handful of whales or in the foundation, right? And so there was always this token increase in 2023 to create a ecosystem fund and to create a treasury, but that has been vesting over 4 years, right? And so those lock tokens can obviously not be voted with. And so the IF so far has participated in governance where it was really necessary to get over the 5% threshold. because oftentimes it was not possible to reach it because people just didn't care to vote, right? And I can fully resonate with that. But ultimately, we need to abide by the rules, and the rules are that we need to reach 5% threshold to get some of these proposals through. And so this is one of the main reasons why the IF participated. But the second point that I wanted to raise, the IF and we as founders are still like one of the most important stakeholders in this project, right? Because the main reason why IOTA is still where it is today is because the community has been amazing and has been loyal to IOTA, but it's also because we as a team have been really committed to drive IOTA forward, right? And we have a certain vision for the project. We have a certain long-standing history and understanding of the market and of IOTA. And so I do think that we are best positioned as well to make decisions on how IOTA should move forward. We do not have majority of the token supply. We do not have any veto rights, right? Still a decentralized network. But I don't think it makes sense for the IF and for us as founders not to participate in governance votes, right? So right now there's the governance vote going on. I think most likely we'll reach the 5% threshold without us, without the foundation participating. So I would really hope for that to happen so that we have a clear way to move forward without the IF actually having to vote. Why are developers less active on Discord and social media? Is this an intentional strategy?
Yeah, I think it's just a misconception, right? We have worked on IOTA Rebased for the last 7 or 8 months in stealth. So our developers were less active on Discord because they also didn't really have much to talk about. But now it being, you know, public and everything, of course, our developers are becoming more and more active on Discord. And I guess also, right, then with the announcement of the or with the change with the builder Discord, that's where most of our developers will probably be the most active, because for them the interaction they want to have is, you know, seeing builders and developers using the software that we are building and engaging with them and, you know, finding out, you know, how does it work for external developers, etc. And that's where most of the engagement will happen. So yeah, it has never been like an intentional strategy or anything like this, but it has just been the case because people were working on a project in stealth, and so there wasn't much to communicate about it in public.
Yeah. Why is it necessary for some IOTA projects to remain secret?
Yeah, okay. I think here it's important to say that we no longer want to, you know, if somebody has an idea or concept in their head within the foundation, we don't want to start a discussion right at that point in time already in the public, because I think it makes much more sense to first ideate and have something written down and, you know, work it out and maybe make some proof of concept, etc. And then at some later point in time, when you have something, you know, which is presentable, then you make it public so that people actually maybe also have an easier time to digest it. Because if you start with an idea from a very early stage on, and it hasn't materialized to anything more tangible, then you might get stuck in a loop where you're just like discussing with people in a public forum all the time. Because it's actually not very clear what the idea is, because it just, you know, hasn't crystallized a little bit more. So also going forward within the foundation, right, if we, for example, have ideas about optimizing certain things, we first want to test it out internally and, you know, scope this out internally. And when we feel like, okay, it makes sense to share this publicly, or, you know, especially if it's something which should have input from the wider community, then of course we're going to do this. But this is also about, you know, protecting our employees from public scrutiny, or like, you know, too long public discussions about a certain thing and maybe then getting stuck. And actually our developers have really enjoyed, you know, working on IOTA Rebased, because they were just able to focus on this without having to be bothered all the time and people asking, why are you doing this like this, or why is it like that, da da da. But I also want to say that we, of course, are no longer going to, you know, have these kind of projects which are so long secret or whatever. That's not the point. I'm just talking about the small features, right? The incremental protocol changes that we make, which we only want to make public or open up the forum to discuss it once we feel like, hey, okay, this is in a presentable state.
Yeah. Maybe just to give my quick two cents is like, people at the IOTA Foundation, like, there's two main jobs, right? Like, make strategic decisions and get shit done, right? And oftentimes, having this public communication is actually in the way of us making sure that we can do work, right? Because we love to be transparent, we love to communicate with the community, but it can also be a distraction for us to do the crucial work, right? And I think everything around IOTA Rebase is very time critical for us to make sure that we actually get it done in time and not having to debate around things, but really make sure that everything is right in place, right in order, so that we can then present it to the community. So with such a huge transformational project, it wouldn't have made sense for us to start leaking things first, right? Because then it would just confuse the community and not provide a coherent or cohesive vision for IOTA, right? So we had to make sure that everything is ready so that we can present this cohesive vision for the community and then present it in a way where it is understandable, right? And that was really critical. And that's what we've done. Can we get better transparency on eco growth wallet spending? We'll definitely share, or we have been sharing a lot in terms of the grants that we have been issuing. So I think on the website here somewhere you can find that, or at least on the blog, you can definitely find the projects that we've been funding over the years. We'll also obviously provide like transparency report from the DAO and the liquidity provision program that we have, where we're managing the unclaimed tokens. So I think many of these reports will then also be publicly accessible to the community to read how the DAO treasury and how the unclaimed tokens are sort of being used as part of the liquidity provision program. We're not going to share things about our internal budget at the foundation or at the various entities for obvious reasons, right? But we will be sharing more about what kind of activities we're doing, and obviously you all will find out about that. Let's do two more questions before we have to head off. Why aren't AMAs hosted on Reddit anymore? Would this help public IOTA engagement? That's very funny.
We should do this. Yeah.
Luca said exactly the same thing before we did the call.
Yeah. I actually, you know, I personally just like more answering questions on Reddit, I guess. I never did it, actually. But I feel like you can give much more, you know, thorough responses. And due to Reddit's auto-sorting with the votes, you're actually getting to the, you know, automatically to the questions which people think are the most important to answer. Yeah. I agree.
I think I definitely like that a lot more as well. I think talking is quite efficient, but I agree with you. Like, it makes a lot more sense to also do AMAs. We also want to do Twitter Spaces. So let's mix up the formats a little bit. So we'll definitely do more of those things. What's the plan for breaking into the US market? US is always a very important strategic market now that also like some of these regulatory hurdles have been resolved. So I think what we're really focused on at the moment is partnerships, right? Working with large financial institutions out of the US to work with them on tokenization or other use cases. And we're already setting up, or we're already working to set up US-based funds, tokenized funds for Realize, right? So that US investors can actually invest into those tokenized funds and manage them fully on-chain on IOTA. The second thing that we work on is exchanges, which is also the other question that I'll work on afterwards, but making sure that we have US exchanges and make IOTA accessible to investors and professional and institutional investors. Right? So I'm 100% committed to making sure that we make that onboarding as smooth and as accessible as possible. Right? And so even though an ETF is further down the line, we should already start those conversations right now. Right? And so this is what we're kickstarting at the moment. Those conversations, and otherwise it's really about showing a presence there, right? Being part of events. So we're already working on sponsoring some US-based events, conferences next year, 2025, potentially even thinking about doing a hackathon further down the line, right, to support builders, and then just really showing a presence, right? By being there personally. I just came back yesterday from New York, and I definitely think that all of us will be spending a lot more time there to figure out how we can or to work on breaking into the US market. So it's not just one single activity, but I think it's like a range of different activities. And it starts by really taking it a lot more seriously, right? And I think right now, we're definitely taking it a lot more seriously. Why hasn't you, and by the way, one thing that's very exciting is obviously we have a lot to prove, right? We have all these projects that we've done in the EU, in Kenya, across Africa now as well, UAE, UK. So I think there's a lot of value that we can actually bring to the US market, right? And a lot of credibility as well. So I think we're in a very different playing field, a level, very different level than other players in the market that want to break into US. So we have a lot of assets to leverage in that regard. Why hasn't IOTA pursued Coinbase listing more aggressively, given its importance for US investors? I would say we haven't pursued. It's not that we haven't pursued it. It's more that Coinbase hasn't really had an incentive to list IOTA, right? And I think that had many different reasons, right? The tech was difficult to integrate. There was some negativity towards IOTA because of 2017-related stuff. And there was just not enough demand, I would say. I think with everything that's happening right now around Rebased, and also with this new technology stack that we have, there's a lot of very good reasons to list IOTA. And so we're obviously very much focused on this right now and pursuing this to make sure that IOTA is finally accessible to US investors on Coinbase. So there's no guarantees. It always takes time, but we're making sure that this will happen. And so we'll not stop until we've made it happen. So I think there's a lot of good stuff there. Sorry that we couldn't do all the questions. I think let's cut it off at the 1 hour mark. So thank you, Luca, for the AMA. Hope you have a wonderful evening, all of you for listening, and see you on Discord. Thank you so much, guys.
Thank you, everyone. Bye-bye.
Bye-bye.